In this video, we are going to talk about stochastic process control, or SPC. I'm going to split this lecture into two videos. The first one, we are going to talk about process control chart for continuous variable, or variables. In the second video, I'm going to discuss control chart for attribute, or categorical variables. In any business process, variation is unavoidable. But there are different kinds of variations. One is called common variation. Sometimes people call that background noise or white noise. Common variation is usually caused by random factors, which is inherent in any process. The other variation is called assignable variation, which is caused by factors that can be clearly identified and managed. That's the kind of variation we would like to identify, manage, and eliminate. One example is traffic. We all know, depending on the time of the day, traffic could be more or less, but that's usual. Unless we have some accident on the freeway, then we have traffic jam. The accident causes the assignable variation. Next, we are going to use something called process control chart to monitor a process and see whether the process is in control or not. In general, there are two kinds of process control charts. The first kind is used to monitor variables. Sometimes we call continuous variables. Things like weight, length, those are the things that can be measured. The other kind of control chart is used to monitor attributes. These are characteristics that can be counted, like errors or mistakes, defects, and so on and so forth. This is typically how a process control chart looks like. In a process control chart, we're going to have a central line that is usually represented by sample mean. More importantly, we're going to identify lower and upper control limit for the process control chart. After we have done that, we can plot our actual observations on this chart, and if observations are going out of bounds, like in the second scenario, generally speaking, we are saying this process is out of control. Next, we're going to look a little bit deeper and see how we can come up with the upper and lower control limit for a process. First, let's look at Xbar chart. Xbar chart is for variables. It shows sample means over time, and we use that to monitor process average. For example, we weigh samples of coffee and compute means of samples, and then we can plot the findings. On this slide, we see the formulas for Xbar chart. And those are the formulas we use to calculate lower and upper control limit for the Xbar chart. X2 bar sometimes is called grand mean, or mean of the sample mean. And Z is nothing but number of standard deviations. Sigma X bar is the standard deviation of sample mean. Sometimes it's called standard error. And this is the formula we use to calculate standard deviation of sample means. This formula comes from central limit theorem. If you are interested in knowing more about it, I can recommend some videos and you can see how central limit theorem comes into play over here. Sigma X is the process standard deviation, and N is the number of observations in a sample. More often than not, it's called sample size. In practice, there's another set of formulas we can use to find Xbar chart and its control limits. The formulas look like this. Here, R bar is the average range. Range is nothing but the difference between the largest sampling unit and the smallest sampling unit in one sample, and R bar is simply the average of all those ranges. And what about A2? A2 is a constant. The value of A2 can be found in this table. This table has already been posted on course website. A2 is used to find 99.73% control limit for Xbar charts. In this table, here's where we can find A2. Depending on the sample size, the value of A2 is also different. In example, we're gonna see how each of those formulas works. Another set of control chart we use to monitor variables is called R chart. R chart monitors variability in the process. Here are the formulas for calculating upper and lower control limit for R chart. Once again, R bar is the average sample range, and D3 and D4 are constant. They can be found once again in the table provided. Here's D3 and here's D4. The values of D3 and D4 provide 99.73% or 3 sigma control limit. Now you may wonder, why do we need both Xbar chart and R chart? Let's take a look. For example, we have a process looking like this. In terms of variability, it's quite consistent. But the mean of the process is shifting upwards. So if we plot Xbar chart in R chart, we're going to find something's not right. If we look at R chart alone, variability wise, it's pretty much a constant. So nothing wrong with that. But when we're looking at Xbar chart, we can clearly see the shift in the sample mean. In the next example, over here, the mean of the process is quite consistent. So there's nothing wrong about this process. If we looked at Xbar chart alone, the sample mean pretty much always stays at the middle. But once we look at R chart and we see something's not right. Why? Because the variability of the process is increasing over time. And that's why we need both Xbar chart and R chart to help us monitor a process. Next, let's turn to our example. This example is coming from semiconductor industry. In the semiconductor business, yield is everything. Yield is basically the number of chips manufactured that are good versus those that are defective. It is commonly accepted that in producing chips, a certain percentage are thrown out. The overall diameter of the batches of semiconductors is a key indicator of the quality. If a chip is too big or too small, it has to be tossed out. Let's say 10 samples were taken and each sample were comprised of 3 batches. The data we've collected are in the Excel file. Let's go to our Excel file. We have 10 samples. In each sample, we have 3 batches. And the number over here shows the average diameter of all the chips in the same batch. Let's see how we can use the information we've collected to come up with the Xbar chart and R chart. First of all, we are going to calculate sample mean. We can take the average of all the 3 diameters within the same sample. Here it is. Next, let's find range. Range is the difference between the largest unit and the smallest unit. So here's what I'm going to do. It's equal to maximum value of all those 3 numbers minus the minimum value of the same 3 numbers. To make it look nice, let's keep 2 decimal places. All right, that will do. Once we have formulas created in the first 2 cells, we can calculate sample mean and range for each of the remaining 9 samples. Here they are. Now let's move on to finding the upper and lower control limit of Xbar chart. You will recall we have 2 sets of formulas. Let's use the first set of formula first. First of all, sample size is going to be 3. Grand mean is going to be the mean of the sample mean. So it's going to be the average of all those 10 sample means. In this case, we do not have the standard deviation of the entire process. So instead, what we're going to do is to use the sample standard deviation to replace the process standard deviation. Sample standard deviation can be calculated using this function. Standard deviation of the entire sample. And SE, standard error, is equal to process standard deviation divided by square root of n. So it's going to be equal to sample standard deviation divided by SQRT sample size, which is 3 in our case. And now we are ready to calculate upper and lower control limit for the Xbar chart. The most popular one is called 3 sigma Xbar chart. Basically, it means that there is 99.73% chance that one observation or one sample mean will be falling within this range. The upper control limit is going to be equal to grand mean plus 3, it means 3 sigma, times our SE. And the lower control limit will be equal to grand mean minus 3 times SE. And once again, to make them look nicer, let's keep 2 decimal places. Now let's try to use the second set of formula to find upper and lower control limit for the Xbar chart. N still 3. And what about Rbar? Rbar is the average of all those 10 sample ranges. And in the formula, we need a constant called A2. Now it's time to go back to the table. A2 for Xbar chart right here, and the sample size for us is 3, so the value for A2 we are going to select is 1.023. And now we are ready to calculate 99.73% upper and lower control limit. The upper control limit is equal to grand mean plus A2 times Rbar. The lower control limit is equal to grand mean minus A2 times Rbar. Okay, here you see we get upper and lower control limit using the second set of formula. The values are a little bit different. Here, I'm not going to go into detail why they are different, but generally speaking, when we're using the second set of formula, we are being more conservative. So that's why we see a wider range, a wider upper control limit. Next, let's move on to the R chart. In order to get upper and lower control limit for R chart, we need D3 and D4. Let's go ahead and find them. Here's the table. D3 and D4 are at the very end. Our sample size n is equal to 3. So D3 is 0. D4 is 2.574. Now we're ready to calculate upper and lower control limit for R chart. Upper control limit will be equal to D4 times R bar. And lower control limit will be equal to D3 times R bar. And it looks like the 99.73% confidence interval for the range is from 0 to 7 millimeters.